We just finished a Kickstarter for our second volume, and that's coming out in 2018. I also am the illustrator of Shadow Warrior with For Seconds, which came out earlier this year, and I'm here to, like, very excited to promote my middle grade graphic novel debut, The Witch Boy, which is coming out on Halloween of this year. So I'm excited to talk about that.
I'm Maggie Shani, and my debut graphic novel, Machina, just came out a couple days ago, actually, with her second books.
Adult themes. And so I really want to make books for kids who maybe don't fit in, maybe they don't know the word for what they are yet, or maybe they do, but they sort of would like to see a character that addresses that without it being kind of this really adult, kind of like explicit content. So that's like what I'm really excited about doing right now.
It's funny, I look to the TV a lot when I think about the type of stories that I want to see in the world. And it's really funny that, like, only within, like, the, like, kind of 2010, like, the last decade, you start seeing sitcoms that are written and run by women, which I love. I like comedy that is a bit more nuanced in that sense. And then I also look to, like, I mean, I look to shows like Issa Rae's Insecure, which is like, which is like a story that is like, like, you look at shows like Shonda Rhimes' Empire, like, and I think that we need more stories that are like by different voices as well. And like recently, I've been thinking about a story like superhero stories get super angsty, and then stories that have queer narratives like tend to be for adults, and it tends to be that weird tragedy porn. That's just, it's all suffering. No one's ever happy.
Yeah.
There is a lot of suffering. So I'm like, how when was the last time there was like a queer rom-com that was like fun and like something that a kid can look forward to? Thanks for snapping. like stuff like that. Just different voices and genres that haven't been traditionally intersecting. So
I'm interested too in like how, when you introduce like sort of diverse characters or characters who sort of stray from like straight white and male, how do the stories change as well? And how do, like, is a queer rom-com, is it different? Is the romance different than a straight romance? And can we explore that? And can we, like, be very proud of that and love that?
Not only are the characters different, but their actual narrative and their story arc is different,
yeah.
Right? So we're not just repeating the same thing, just making them.
It's like one episode of Master of None, the Thanksgiving episode. And it was like, oh my gosh, here's an entire episode of like queer black woman, and it's like funny and sad and weird, and like, we just need more of that so we can have more, narrative.
Yeah.
I feel like on the way over, and this thought's not completely worked out yet, because I just was thinking about it, is that, I wish there was like a Bechdel test.
Bechdel test.
You know, for people of color. So it'd be having a comic book with more than two lead Latinos or people of color, and they, what they talk about is something other than the fact that they are people of color.
Yeah.
So something like that, like I think you were talking about like some sort of rom-com mix-up or something, some mashup of genres. I want to see more of that. I want to see more and more. I mean, a lot of the Latino stories that get told are border stories. And some of them are great, and some of them suck. And there's a lot of Chicano stories, and some of them are great, like Love and Rockets, and some of them are. And I want to see more of a diverse amount of storytelling within Latinos.
I think it's interesting too. Like, a lot of us are talking about our own experiences, and one of the things that I think is not necessarily super representative is mixed race. I'm raising a mixed race child right now, and she speaks two languages. She's two, she speaks two languages, and you know, I think about this. I'm making these books as books that I have liked to read when I was young. Oh, where are the books for her? Where are the books for literally generation of mixed race children who are coming from all different backgrounds and speaking multiple languages and getting multiple cultures represented? And that's another gap in the market that I'd love to see addressed.
So you are all not teenagers or kids anymore. you're all writing books for teens or kids, and you are not yourself a teenager or a kid. And you guys, I knew just saying the experiences for young people today, they're in some way different from the experiences that we all grew up with. How are you writing your story and including those new experiences of children so that they reflect the world that people are living in now or the world that you want those kids to be living in now?
It's a little terrifying because teens are so smart. And there's so much on a different level than I was when I was their age. But I think for me, when I was a kid, I really liked books that didn't talk down to me, and so I would end up reading a lot of adult fiction because I didn't like a book that treated me like I was a little dumb. And so when I write for kids, I just try to not shy away from complicated or vague issues, and to maybe present them in kind of like a safe way or a stories where you can like choose how deep you get into it. Like you can sort of read it on surface level as an adventure, or you can go deeper and really like get into these like complicated emotional ideas. But like I'm writing for kids like me who are very serious and want it to be like taken seriously.
I think it's important to be around children.
Yeah.
Kind of like do your research, not being creepy and like hang out, you know, but you will friends with kids.
Okay.
And then I think the other thing that's really important is to, like you said, not talk down to them, but to make sure that you're maintaining your voice while you're doing it.
I think I had responses to both of what you guys said. Like being around kids and teens is so important. I remember I was talking to an editor from a place that will not be named. He was like, yeah, we're going to do something really fresh, or like sort of start something new here. And I was like, oh yeah, so you can look this, you can look this. And he heard Homestuck, he was like, what's Homestuck? I was like, oh, do you make comics, or what are you doing? But kind of in that same respect, I love media that is for kids that doesn't speak down to kids. Because when I was like 12, I was watching SpongeBob and I was watching Frasier, and I would laugh at that as So it's something where, like, when I actually write, I actually do not think about, I can't say I'm like thinking like, how is a teen going to respond to this? Because I'm lucky enough where, like, I've had parents and their children both like come to my table and read Check Please, like they're reading it together. And I think that I honestly think that adults when they're writing for teens they should just treat them like just I mean there shouldn't be things you can't talk about and that's pretty much the only boundaries. You should just treat them like they are adults because that's how they want to be treated.
Yeah, I agree. But I think it's like it's a trap if you try to think too hard and get into the head of someone who's 30 years, 40 years younger than you, you just end up patronizing them. On the other hand, though, I also think there's something to be said for humility, like not thinking you know it all and kind of observing. And you know, I have two kids, so I tend to watch them a lot and just kind of figure it out.
Like, panels at New York Comic Con, you kind of like fit the entire world in a 200-page story. So how do you get the diversity and the resonant effect of multicultural, multinodal world into a book?
I know that in undergrad, like something that my screenwriting professor pointed out was like the more specific you get, the more universal you get actually. And it's a weird thing where like when I'm writing a story about a character, like any identity, I will do my research if it's not something that I identify with, and I'll ask my friends, and most of the time I'll base it off like a specific experience of my friend. And I have people who say like, well, I identify with that.
Why would I make this character white? Like, why not make something else? And like to be like, I don't need to be. This character doesn't need to like represent a group of people. Like the character is who they are in the story, but like I can like examine biases that I might hold, or like just. Like ignorance that I might have.
But I feel like that's you're already like putting so much pressure on yourself. That's like it's so hard. And I feel like especially on the internet, people are like, well, you better get it right or else we're gonna, you know, call out those.
Yeah.
That's
kind of that common. It's an okay.
I think that all creators are gonna get called out for something. You're not gonna make everybody happy. Somebody's gonna get angry about some way you're representing
somebody or not representing somebody. And I think that that's fine. There's a certain amount that we can learn from that, from those discussions. And there's a certain amount that you have to ignore because you can't satisfy everybody. And you have to focus on the character and what that character's experience is, what their favorite foods are, you know, who their best friends are, how many heartbreaks they've had in their lives. And once you know that about your character, then your character is not a character anymore. They're a real person. They're living with you. They're in the back of your mind as you're like writing your pages or drawing them. And that's what makes it real. That's what makes it universal, actually, just like you said, the more specific.
Like, just because you talked about this, like I was reading your book, and I was like, I really like how, like, you'll mention, like, Indian words or Indian holidays, and the book doesn't stop to explain it, it's just kind of part of the language of the book. It sort of jumps on what we were talking about in the last topic about not condescending, not patronizing. Just kind of, you just reflect what, you know, what reality is.
Yeah.
You don't stop to explain it. And you always will get just enough. Hopefully that you get the story and it feels like a full world.
It's contextual, right? Yeah. I mean, I gave enough context. I worked really hard to give enough context in Kashina where I didn't have to sanitize my work, right? Like, I don't want to have to wash it down, because washing it down would be embedding it in.
Yeah. Like sometimes, some of the, talking about preschool, some of the preschool shows I've worked on in the past, if it's a Spanish word, you have to stop and say what the word means. And I never really liked that. I always prefer to just, kids will get it, or they won't get it, or it's contextual, and if they don't get it, it doesn't ruin the story. They just didn't get that, adios, goodbye. So, I like, you know, let them figure it out.
So a lot of you are writing those really fantasy elements in them, diversity and fantasy at the same time. Is there an added depth in, or difficulty in creating a diverse world that's not necessarily our world, that has diverse characters or a diverse setting, but the meaning of the diversity is not necessarily what it is on, like, Earth 2 here.
Wait, what do you mean? Like, sorry, I zoned out for a second.
No, I was listening.
So it's an intense question.
Yeah.
That's a great question. So if you're creating a fantasy universe,
yeah,
or a universe that's our world, but there's a ultimate fantasy element. And there's diversity in that fantasy part of your story,
yeah,
but the diversity doesn't necessarily mean the same thing that it does on Earth here.
Okay, so
yeah,
when
so
you're not necessarily using like
the
concrete
diversity
here, how do you...
I mean, to me, it's also kind of a fine line between like tokenism and having like three-dimensional characters in it. So like we have some characters, like one character's in a wheelchair, but that seems very natural. It's a blacksmith who lost a fight with a dragon, so he lost his legs and his arms. And that feels very natural to that world. So any kind of diversity we try to fuse our world with, we try to make it feel like it's a part of that world.
In my book, I enjoy using sort of a metaphor of magic to explore certain like queer themes. And it's like, it's a book where like magic is very gendered, and it's about a boy who wants to do girl magic. And so it's kind of like exploring some ideas. While I think for me, I like enjoy having a little bit of a light touch that means that like kids who need to identify with that could, and kids who kind of just are there for the adventure story can get that. So yeah, I think you definitely can sort of like use the conceit of magic in your story to explore things in a way where it's like maybe a little gentler or a little less specific or like a little bit like easier for kids to engage with.
I mean, yeah, and I feel like I was a bit facetious before saying, like, oh, my story's about hockey, therefore it's not fantasy. But I think every story and every world that you enter has rules. And the only difference between fantasy and sci-fi is, like, saying these rules are ordained by science or these rules are ordained by magic or supernatural. And I think when it comes to diversity or portraying queerness or race or capability and disability, it's really about... It's all you're doing is critiquing those rules, and like it's really interesting that you're talking about how magic is gendered,
mm-hmm,
and then suddenly that becomes a rule to break,
mm-hmm,
and then the diversity comes from how people engage with it.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you all. That was really interesting. So, when you're making stories for kids, do you think diversity is particularly important for the age category that you're writing for in a specific way?
I think it's important in every story. I think it's, I don't know, because I've done adult work and then this is my first children's book. And it's, I don't know, it's just been something I've thought about across the board for everything I've done. I think for kids it's like, it's what I love about making fiction for kids is that they are like such pure readers and they're so, you really have this chance to like shape their idea of the way the world is and what they can expect and like what they can believe in. And what they can look up to, and so it's important in that way. But I wouldn't like give someone a pass for not thinking about diversity for adult books.
I think that it's important for all books. However, I think that the increased importance is placed on children's literature is because you can reach those people that might not be familiar with those communities or those cultures, and then hopefully influence them in a way that's positive, right? To incorporate those things that are not familiar into their lives, to be more open to them, and to be able to impact kids at that age, and to have them, because they're so spongy, right? They're really, they want to read everything, what's cool, what their friends are reading, and to be able to affect them, and then hopefully to impact them in a way that would make them less messed up later. You know, I mean, basically that's what I'm trying to say. You know, that's really important.
Yeah, I think it's like a literacy and empathy. Like, you learn how to feel as a kid, and then you still have to practice that empathy as an adult. So it may be more important as when you're a child, so, yeah.
Is the question if it's more important or equally important, or?
Is it more important, or is there something specific that's like a more specific, like an aspect, or is there something that resonates more with kids? Like, is there diversity in kids' stories working in a different way than diversity in adult stories?
Well, me personally, I think it's more important for the kids in the same way that it's more important for my kids to eat better than I eat. You know? I'll be dead in 15 years, so my kids will be around for a while. And I find it so smart. Maybe I'll live longer. I did smoke for 11 years, I gave it up. I get so angry though when I'm looking for it. I get so angry when I was trying to find like books for my kids who are now 10 and 7. And you know, every Latino story is about let's go make tortillas with Abuelita, Day of the Dead, Piñata story. And I found it so annoying. And I'm going to tell a quick story. But this is a story. Did anybody ever read Skippy John Jones? So it's this picture book. And it's this picture book that my sister bought for me. And I don't know why she bought it for me, because she thought it had some Spanish in it, he'll like it, that sort of thing. And I read it for my son, and it's full of like, it's about a Siamese cat that wants to be a Chihuahua. And it's full of mock Spanish and canito words and there's some chimichanga rhymes and I hated this book. And also I felt guilty throwing it away and I felt guilty giving it away. I could hide it if I can't find it. And I had to keep reading this book and even the CD of the author reading it. The author is not in color. But this book won an E.B. White Award. It was a New York Times bestseller. They made a musical out of it. There's, if you want to buy a Skippy John Jones doll, you can, feel free. And I'm sure this author's not a bad person. I'm sure she's fine. But when I finished reading, I thought, this is either racist or dumb. And I had it Googled, and I Googled racist or dumb. Actually, somebody had written something, a whole blog post about racist or dumb. I think it's dumb, probably. But just that's what we have, that's what my kids have to read. Is like some cat that wants to be a Chihuahua and uses mock Spanish and talks in cliches, and that's a bestseller.
When did this come out?
Recently, like that. Well, okay, like my client.
It was like in the past 10 years.
Yeah. So I'm sorry if any Skippy John Jones fans are out there.
So are you all seeing that change? Or are you seeing things today be different in reverse publishing than they were 10 years ago or when?
For me, absolutely. When I was a kid, there was nothing.
Yeah, my bubble is very influenced by what I like. So, like, I think I see all the good, diverse comics that are coming out. But yeah, I mean, it seems like there's a really big change happening. I think it just also seems like so many kids these days are so much more aware of social issues and like aware of different ways to be and how to be respectful of other kinds of people. Like, I think it's really exciting.
Yeah, I mean, I'm coming from the world of webcomics, and webcomics, they are the place for diversity and to find stories about people dealing with different mental issues and mental health issues. It's a plethora. Like, you can really like type in like, okay, space, mental health, like gender identity comic, and we'll have like 20 comics. It's fantastic. I think it might be harder. I think the next step is kind of cultivating that information to make sure that the people who and the young readers that need that can find that information safely. But yeah, when I started reading about comics, it was all like, you know, like video game, anime, cats talking about stuff. So I appreciate that it's more nuanced now.
I think that the industry is changing on the content side. I don't always think that it's changing on the creator side. And there's still a lot of work to be done. I think that there are, and then how many books are created with lead characters or created with characters of color, and then how many of those are made by diverse creators. And the percentages are abysmal. I think that it's definitely different than when we were growing up. I can go to a bookstore and find a book or two that I feel comfortable bringing into my house and reading like 500 times because I'm a 2-year-old. You know, I still think that there's a lot of growth.
With this current state of the world, I feel like we've all spent a lot of time talking about activism today. Do you feel like you are being an activist with the stories that you're telling? And do you feel like that's important? Being an activist is an important identity for a writer or an illustrator today?
I don't know if activist is the very first word that would come to my mind. I mean, I consider myself a storyteller with a passion. And, you know, I tend to have, you know, I want to push diversity as much as I can in my work. And I guess that is my activism, but I consider myself a storyteller.
I kind of agree, because I feel like activism is so selfless and noble and brave, and I think storytelling is that way and the same. But it's hard to just like kind of claim that mantle, because it's saying a lot about yourself, and it's, I don't know, it's like saying like I'm a hero basically, which is
hard to do.
Yeah, it's hard. I feel like the people who are the most active activists, they use different terms for themselves. That's like such a loaded term. It comes with a lot of responsibility and
Yeah. I mean, I think a lot about making stories as a force for good, and that's kind of where I come from. Every time I sit down to write or start on a project, it's just like, what does this mean? What is this saying? How can this push towards the vision of a world that I like would believe in? And I think as a writer and a creator, it is it's a practice of empathy and of learning and of always being open to learning other experiences and seeing every single person around you as a whole person. I think like the act of creation is really powerful, but yeah.
It's hard.
Yeah. It's hard too. It's scary. And I think it's like some people bear that responsibility, like it weighs a lot heavier on them than others, and some people never think about it. And I don't know. It's interesting.
I think the term activism, like you were saying, it's hard to kind of take ownership over it. But I definitely think that art is political. I think that as an artist, you have a responsibility to share the things that you believe in as much as you do the work that's just for fun. One of the things that I did when, was elected, start creating these free coloring pages that were focused on a character, which I have so much work now, I haven't come back to it, but just a girl who goes kind of on a journey and finds people along her way, and they help each other out. They're free coloring pages. And I think that I wouldn't necessarily call it an activist practice or anything, but there are things that I need to do in my life in order to feel that I'm participating. And if I can look into my toolbox and say, what can I do? How can I help these conversations happen? How can I help teachers or nonprofit workers and the people who are on the front lines and have these pools of influence to have these conversations that are really, really difficult? And so I try to do that work and think about what I can provide with my toolbox, because I'm not really going to be super useful by volunteering my time. I can be really.
So the two books out so far, it's the same character. So Giants Beware is about Claudette, who's a young girl warrior who wants to convince her little brother and her best friend to go kill a giant. And her best friend is named Marie, and she is a wannabe princess slash diplomat. And she wants to negotiate peace between monsters and the villagers. And there's a third character, Gaston, who's her little brother, who wants to grow up. He's a scaredy cat. He's scared to go kill this giant. And he wants to be a pastry chef slash sword maker. So everybody kind of has their dreams. And it all takes place in this medieval French village.
My story is called Checkplays, which again is totally for free online at checkplayscomic.com, but it's going to be in bookstores in the fall of 2018, published through First Second. It's the story of a former figure skater who joins a college hockey team, and he really likes to bake. His thing, the catch, is that he's very scared of that physical part of hockey, which is called the checking. You know, when you get hit with a board, he turned into a fake team, it's terrible. And it's a story about, I started it on a whim, actually, but, the story that kind of developed is the story of self-acceptance. Biddy is this character, the main character, his name is Eric Biddy Biddle. Everyone in hockey has nicknames because of Biddy, because he's also very small, see? Mm-hmm. but his thing is that he has so much, the first time he ever comes out to anyone is in college, and he does it in a, hyper-masculine environment of hockey. And the story that I wanted to tell, instead of a queer character who, gets ostracized or hated, I wanted to tell a story about him going into an environment and changing it, and these characters having no choice but to support him. And it's ultimately a pretty happy story about a kid who kind of makes it in hockey.
That's awesome. Okay. and Pashmina is about Priyanka Das, who is an Indian American girl who finds a magical Pashmina shawl and allows her to travel to a fantasy version of India, and that encourages her to ask questions and be curious about who she is and where she came from. And a lot of the story is about a relationship with her mother, a relationship with history that she's been protected from, and eventually she ends up going to real India, and it's also about that contrast. A lot of the book is about contrast.